Welcome, everyone, to a new edition of Codum X. I would like everyone to, if they have a question, please wait until we pass the catch box to you. But it's okay to ask questions during the talk. Also, afterwards, there'll be a little bit of room for questions. Please turn off your cell phones and enjoy the talk.
Yes. So today we have two speakers at the room. That's Annalise and Emil. They both work at Abbott's. Abbott's is a Dutch manufacturing company that has global presence. So they engineer mission-critical technologies that works for different industries and also for everyday use. So today they are going to share with us why these technologies matter and also how they make real progress that is financially rewarding, but also in a humane and environmental friendly way. So let's give a round of applause to Annalise and Emil.
Thank you. Yes, today I will talk about how mission-critical technologies can ensure a healthy planet. I'm responsible for sustainability worldwide, and after my talk I will give the floor to Emil. He will do a deep dive in the technologies that we have and also talk about the digitalization of the products and how that helps to make them to have sustainable impact. Yes, it was a very nice introduction. This is the core of what we do. We engineer mission-critical technologies for groundbreaking industries and everyday life. We are where technology matters and real progress can be made, humanly, environmentally, and financially. We are a stock-listed company, and we are with over 16,000 people, and we work from, 150 locations in about 50 countries. 4.5 years ago, I started working at Albert's as a legal counsel, and I asked for an electric car as a lease car, because at that time we were in the middle of nowhere, somewhere in the Netherlands. And now, 4.5 years later, I'm responsible for sustainability worldwide. And why do I tell you that? That's because it really represents how it works at Albert's. We are a no-nonsense, pragmatic company, and you will get a lot of opportunities there. We have a legacy of 40 years entrepreneurship. So, that's the Albert's way. With our technologies, we want to make sustainable impact. In 4 years' time, we made the turn from just being a technology company to being a technology company with sustainable impact. How do we approach that? If you look at the world we are living in today, you see a lot of problems like climate change, rising sea levels, extreme weather conditions, etc. And on the other hand, the population is growing, population is getting wealthier, they want more comfort, and they want to travel more. You can look at it as a problem, but you can also look at it as something where technology can give a solution for that. And as engineers, we want to be part of that solution and contribute to that solution. We look at megatrends that are here right now, like rapid urbanization, climate change and resource scarcity, and Internet of Things, and focus on that in our end markets. We are shaping eco-friendly buildings and driving sustainable transportation, and also support semicon efficiency with our technologies. The eco-friendly buildings section will be explained by Emil. For sustainable transportation, we are active on land, in the air, and by sea. For example, we have fuel management systems which make sure that you can decrease with your fuel in container ships up to 20%. We engineer solutions for electrical cars, for hydrogen cars, for CNG cars. And we have also all kind of solutions to reduce the weight in airplanes. We are a real progress can be made. And in the new head office in Utrecht, we are in the WTC of Utrecht, we also have a real, in case of real progress, button, which you can press if there is a case of real progress. And I hope to push that button many times when there are new technologies with sustainable impact. And now Emil will explain what kind of new technologies we are making at the moment.
Yes, thank you. I pushed that button once. That's my hand. So we made some progress. within the hydronic flow control business. And that is one segment within, one business segment within Aalberts. It's called climate technology. And climate technology is the business where we are producing, developing, and delivering installations for eco-friendly buildings. The Hydronic Flow Control Group, it's called, has two different groups, Flamco Group and Comac Group. It's about 2,000 employees, a little bit more than 500 million euros turnover. We are engineering and manufacturing products, but we are doing more. We are also now in the process of delivering services. And in the end, we want to deliver complete solutions to extend the lifetime of buildings and to reduce cost of ownership of those buildings. So if you look to the to just give a picture about what we deliver on inside these buildings is basically the complete distribution of heating and cooling inside a building. So from the source, which is could be a gas boiler or a heat pump, we don't deliver those, but everything what is in between until the emitter of the heat and the cooling. That's our part inside a building. So we have a lot of facets where we can adjust and make sure that we get the most out of this heat, which is produced here, until it gets delivered to the ones who have comfort of it. Just some examples. In London, Battersea Power Station, big power station, which was used for delivering electricity to London, about one-fifth of the electricity. And now they are turning this nice building into a new place to live and for shops. There will be 20,000 apartments in there. And what we deliver here is that complete system. So from making sure that the energy which is produced will be used in those apartments in the most efficient way. Another building close by in the Netherlands, in Amersfoort, it's the prenatal head office in the Netherlands. Also a big building which they wanted to build eco-friendly. So using a lot of solar inlet, but also the climate comfort is very important to balance that and to make sure that that it has the right system, cooling and heating, to have a right environment for all the people that work there and all the people that visit. The change we made during the last years is that instead of just delivering products, because that's what we did, we produced products, we delivered it to our customers, and that's basically the end of, we didn't hear of them then, until there was a problem, we got a call, can we get a spare part or some help? And now we've changed our philosophy. We want to be part of that building installation throughout the complete life cycle. And why? To basically to add value to our systems throughout the complete lifetime. So that means that not only during construction we are helping to deliver those products and to install those products, but we are also helping about, okay, how can you get the best performance out of these systems? What kind of systems do you need? What kind of solutions? How piping dimensions, etc. After it's being installed, it's also very important that it gets commissioned well. Because without a good commissioning, you won't have the best energy efficiency out of that products and out of that installation that we put in. But then during operation, there's a lot to measure about heating usage, water usage, but also to maintain. How can we maintain the products in that way that we expand the lifetime and that we keep that system, which is once commissioned, that we keep that system on a very high level, that it performs very well. Because otherwise, energy, that's what you see in most buildings, it's put in, then it's commissioned very well, But then, yeah, after the years, then offices change on the inside. There are more or less people. People are turning on the airco and the settings. And then you see that the energy efficiency of a building really drops. It drops 20-25%. So to make sure that we get the best out of that system, we want to be involved in that maintenance. Well, our biggest target groups at the moment are installers and wholesalers. So we are selling our products via wholesalers to the installers. But due to this new strategy, that is changing. So we are more and more now offering our solutions to project developers or end users like housing associations, because they value that they have a lower cost of ownership. So what we are doing now is to make that happen, this building life cycle, we are putting an umbrella of services on top of our product portfolio. And the thing that we spoke out is, okay, we connect it smarter from source to emitter. And if you then look to all those services, then we are talking about design and calculation. And so we are putting in place calculation tools so that that we can help picking the right products and the right solution. We can do prefabrication, training, commissioning and balancing. We also are digitalizing that part of the job, so making life for installers and service engineers easier. We have come up with metering services to measure all the water and energy uses inside the building and to do some energy management. We are looking at remote service so that we can help service engineers and service parties to effectively maintain the building. Of course, maintenance and the repair service. Looking at those services, we really were thinking about, okay, how can we digitalize this? How can we use software to make this easier to do? So how can we put new business models in place? So what we did is looking at the complete life cycle of the building and looking at all the different positions we have there and thinking about, okay, how can we, what is this customer doing? How can we help him? How can we make life easier? And what can we then provide? So first, this architect or consultant, he needs to make a nice construction, a plan, construction plan. So we need some planning tooling. So we now have calculators on our website, which calculate which products to use, which installations are the best performing for that building. And in future, we want to use data that we are now collecting out of those buildings to even be better in planning on what is best practice for those buildings. So it's also about collecting data, analyzing it, and putting it in that planning tool to optimize the planning for a building. Second step is that, yeah, then they have to acquire this product. So we are putting up an e-commerce e-commerce website where people can easily then, when they have decided on their project, they can easily order the goods. They can, Amazon or Mano Mano, they can easily put all the products in their in a basket and buy it. So we're also digitalizing that part of the business. Just like we are used to, if we look to bol.com or Amazon, we are all used to working in that way as buying trousers or new school gear. But in business to business, they're very conservative. So and what you see more and more is that also installers and also wholesalers are more and more going into e-commerce and thinking, hey, I can buy my home appliance via web shop. So why can't I buy these products for the installation via the web shop? We're working on connectivity. So all the products that we deliver where we have electronics inside, we are also making sure that we can connect it. via Bluetooth, via LAN networks, and also via GSM. That connectivity we are using for apps that we use for commissioning. So we call it the service tool belt app. So that service engineer doesn't only have his tools with him, but also a tablet. And with that tablet, he can connect to our product. And we use it for remote service. So when we are able to get information, data out of our product, and we can analyze it in our portal, then we can offer remote service and metering. So if you look not only to the technology side of this, but also to the business side, then it's all about creating new business models. I think it's very nice that we can technology, we can do anything, we can create anything, but it also needs a good business model behind it. And the most important thing is that we add value to the customer. So and then there are several ways. So basically we were selling analog products, one-off sales, and we are moving to digital. So making sure that there are electronic components on our products that gather data. And we are also moving to recurring. So that means that we offer services on a monthly basis, so monthly subscription. So you order a product where we have remote service. And that remote service is based on a monthly payment. And you will have access to a portal and will get the information about how that product is doing. And if there are alerts, you will be notified as a service company. The next step, and that's basically what we are already thinking of now, is, okay, now we are selling that product and we are offering that service with a recurring fee. But what about bringing heating as a service? So not only selling the product, so that we will only do recurring and digital. So that means having a service, having a subscription model where we are supplying the product and only charge a monthly fee to the housing association or the building owner for heating, for example. So he doesn't have to invest in all those materials. We can supply the product, and then it's more about services. So we are then making sure that the heating will be always working 24 hours, 7 days a week. And then we can provide insight into the maintenance. We can give insight into the energy usage. And we can make sure that when it fails, that we send someone over who can repair the installation. Creating those business models is very important because that will basically carry your development on the digital side. So we are now putting in development in an agile way. So starting with a minimal viable product, putting that in the market, and getting feedback from our customers to find out, hey, are we on the right way? Are we giving enough value? And what price can we ask for it? What service can we then continue to develop to have this service grow? And in that way, we are now putting up several projects and already introducing the first propositions into the market. So we have now three products, which are installation products, which we use, where we have embedded all connectivity, like Bluetooth, but also gateways with GSM. And we will now launch, in the next month, we will launch our service tool belt app, which has been developed by us in cooperation with a partner. To make commissioning easier. So it will guide you to commissioning. So we have a lot of programmers working on making the best human interface, on making what is the customer journey, what does he do, what does this installer or service engineer do, but also about technology. How do we make a safe Bluetooth connection with the devices? What do we need to do on the embedded systems inside those devices, which we are also developing. So this is the first step to digitalize products. There's no human interface anymore, except on this product, but on these products, there's no human interface anymore. So we took away all the knobs and all the displays, and we said, well, we just provide an app, and with that app, you can adjust and set the product. Then the next thing that has been launched is the remote service platform. So here it's very important that at first we went to all these customers that are service companies who have a built building they have to maintain. And the biggest problem they have is currently that they don't get personnel anymore. If you see vans on the street, there's always, hey, we are looking for colleagues. And knowledge is draining away. So the most important thing for service companies is that they want to work more efficiently. They want to, when they send out a service engineer, they have to go there once and fix the problem. And what we see now is that there is a service engineer going to a problem because the customer called. He first has to find out, hey, what is the problem? Where does the error come from? What part is broken? Then he finds out he doesn't have that part with him, so he has to go back. And so what you see is that mostly two or three times a visit is paid before the problem is solved. With remote servicing, we have a live connection with the product, so we are continuously gathering data from the product, and we can immediately see if problems occur, or even by doing analytics on all the products that we have installed, we can also predict when things go wrong. So we can predict when an expansion vessel, for example, will break. And that will give the service engineer or the service company the chance to plan the next visit instead of going there because it already has been broken and it has to be repaired right now. So there's a lot of benefit, a lot of value in that for these customers. So what we did is we put up a first POC, a proof of concept, to see how this concept is what the reaction is on this concept, putting it at several customers. And then we start working on the portal. Okay, what kind of services does he want? What can we build? How does he want to, does he want to look at? So the first screen is always an overview of all his products and which products are broken, because that's important for him. And then he can send out a service engineer to those buildings where they need something to fix. Another thing is a metering service. So when there is operation, when the building is already occupied, then you want to really see, okay, what is the energy usage of a building? So the first step we are doing is making sure that all the meters that we are installing, that we can digitally retrieve that data from remote. So we implemented gateways which are gathering all the metering data wireless. We are sending it over to our portal. And we are now, the first step is that we deliver that to our customers so they can do the billing for the tenants. The next steps are, so this already gives enough value for housing associations, for example, to implement the system. Now our next step is to look at this data and to analyze it and to think about energy management. So where do we see differences? Do we see differences within the building on certain apartments or certain floors? Or how many energy is lost between the source and the emitter? So by now being able to analyze that data, we will go more and more into energy management inside a building. So it offers a lot of potential. I just want to show you, this was a first movie we made when we thought about those business models and the propositions I just showed, to explain also internally in the organization, because digitalization is not is also something new for internal organizations, just to show our thoughts about, okay, how can this work for us, and what can we then add as value.
The Internet of Things can be found everywhere, in all the devices we use. Flamco believes in a smart connection of things from source to emitter. This will change the way we work with our heating and cooling infrastructure.
The future of heating and cooling lies in the connection between hardware and digital services. The reliability of your climate system does not only depend on installing the best performing hardware. At Flamco, we also give you helpful tools and information via our digital platforms. This should help in maintaining your systems and making buildings more sustainable. We also deliver relevant data for your business, for instance, for billing heat. By connecting our hardware, we let the data tell the story of heating and cooling. We connect it smarter to serve our customer needs.
We are creating solutions for all our devices. If you buy your groceries at home online, then why not buy your Flamco service online? Once you receive the product, commissioning will become effortless when you use the Flam Connect app to install your device. Once you've installed your system, it will be permanently monitored online. In case of failure, you can be notified via our service. Your customer doesn't even have to notice that something went wrong. This is how we make sure your visits are effective and make maintenance and replacement plannable. Flamco. We connect it smarter from source to emitter.
So I think this gathers all the different propositions and the thoughts we had. And we launched this before we even had all those propositions in place, just to bring the idea over to the customer so that he could think, okay, this really adds value to my company. To make all this happen, we of course need some of you who are very interested. Implementing those new business models also brings new challenges for us, because we were used to being a company producing and innovating on products, and now we are moving more and more into services and digitalization. So if we look to the team of digital products and connectivity, then we are now doing a broad scope of developments and innovations, where we are working with app developers, but also developers on embedded software, portals, so JSON, Python, data analytics, to provide information about, okay, where can we improve our services, where can we improve on predictive maintenance. We'll also do some AI implementations and configuring all the portal on the front end. So we are working on basically different levels of development inside this digital spectrum, which is very interesting. We are also working together with a lot of external parties, because they have in-depth knowledge of app development or portal development, which we use to really speed up the process. Besides this, because digitalization is not only about products and connectivity, we are also digitalizing our sales funnel. We used to, there used to be a lot of account managers going to those installers, drinking a cup of coffee and trying to sell the new product. And what we are now putting in place is that we have more and more trying to create attraction by social media, by search engine advertising, possibilities to get attraction, to do conversion on the website, to convert strangers to leads, to nurture those leads. And eventually also make sure that then they get customers. The planning tool is one of those items which you put on the website, where you can, where we really can see, okay, in what kind of project is this this visitor interested? What is he calculating? What is he putting together? So, and then we can help him find out, hey, what could be the best solution for your project? So there's a lot of development also going on this side of digitalization and programming, programming websites, programming these kinds of tools. If we then look to that team, that's more about web page management, but also creating search engine advertising, creating ads, also data analytics. So looking at all the data that we gather from websites and sales leads via different tools that we use to follow those leads throughout the complete customer journey. And there are also smart tools are used to really move those leads to customers. So the question is, what can we do for you? I'm very curious. I only know what we need. People that add value, it's very important for Aalbert, that get beyond the known. So really try to go beyond the border. Like to challenge themselves and create a new, enjoy creating new stuff. If you look to the Aalbert values and the Aalbert culture, I think that's very important to notice. We have basically five values, so act with integrity, share and learn. So we are not only within our business segment, but also across the business segment. So also with the automotive guys, the industrial guys, we are exchanging information. Also within digital, we have a network where we are working together with all those different companies, which are working for ASML or working for the automotive industry, to just find out, okay, what is happening in those industries, which with things that we can use, knowledge that we can use. Go for excellence. So we always try to do better. But the most, the biggest, the most important ones, I think, for the business that means digitalization, which I am in, is be an entrepreneur, because we really need to create new business models. Then you need to be an entrepreneur to try out things, to test things, to think in a different way than all the other companies are doing. And what is important within Aalbert is that if you have a great idea, you will be supported. You will get the chance to really bring that idea into the market or take it some levels up. But it also means that to take ownership. So if you work for Aalbert or doing internship for Aalbert, then it's up to you. It's they give you a lot of freedom and support, but you really have to then take ownership of it and make the best of it. So I would say get connected and to boost your personal development. Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation, Emil. And now it's time for some questions. Does any of you guys have any questions already? Okay, great.
Yes. So I was just wondering, wasn't completely clear to me, who are your customers? Are they the engineers who install it, or are they the people commissioning the buildings, or are they the...
Yeah, it's our customers used to be or are still the installers and the wholesalers. So you have installers that are installing the equipment in the first phase of the building, which are supplied via the wholesaler. But by the change we made to bring in more services and solutions throughout the complete life cycle, then the installers is only, if you remember that picture with the life cycle, the installer is only there when the product gets installed. And then he he signs off, and that's his job. So for the services that that are coming behind that, so like remote service, metering service, our new customers basically are the housing associations or the project developers. So big, like this area, this has been developed by a project developer, and they are not thinking about, okay, I want to have lowest cost products. No, they're thinking about, okay, how can I maintain this building in the most efficient way? How can I cut cost on the ownership? So we are talking more and more to those kind of customers now to supply them with these services. Any other questions? Yeah.
Hi, so you mentioned that you have AI implementation earlier. I wonder if you can go into a bit more detail about what sort of things you're trying to achieve with that.
We don't have AI implementation. So we are currently at a stage where we have a lot of products connected, and we are now basically doing a lot of data analysis on that data to get to a predictive maintenance. We are trying to get algorithms in place that will, for example, measure when there is a leakage inside one of those products. We can see that there is a leakage, but it will only give an error when, for example, that big vessel, that red vessel that you saw, when it's empty, then it will give an error, but then it's already leaking for a week, for example. And we also want to find out how can we measure, how can we get that out of the data, that we can do pre-warnings, so that that we can advise the service companies to already plan a service on this device, so it won't go in error. So that's the stage where we are now by using the data that we are gathering.
I have another question. I was just wondering, do you take the behavior of the end user into account? Because you mentioned that you wanted to make things comfortable and sustainable, but I feel from my working experience that people are often fighting climate control systems and stuff instead of feeling comfortable because they have no ownership. Do you take this into account?
Yeah, we are, if you look to the complete system that we are delivering, then it's mainly the boiler room system, which we put in place. But also if you look to COMAP, which is the also part of hydraulic flow control, they are working more on, how to call it, smart home features, like smart thermostats. And they are working on more on the comfort side. So they are really taking the customer or the end user into account on, okay, how can we make the climate inside a certain room more comfortable? How can we adjust the different zones in a house that you will always be in a comfortable climate.
It was more about the business, like in workplace where people have different preferences and things like that, and people want the window open or the air conditioning on or off.
Yeah.
I mean, do you take this into account in optimizing for sustainability? I was kind of wondering how you do that.
Yeah, if you look to the companies that we are our customers, so who are maintaining the building and we have to optimize the system, they are taking that into account. They are, because of all the developments, not only in our part of the business of that building, but also because it's a combination of your windows and your window shutters, the sun shining into the building, your air conditioning, your heating. So it's a combination of factors which make it comfortable for you. And with all the new technologies and new sensors, sensor technology, they can more precisely detect climate within a certain area and adjust in a certain area. So when you look at new buildings, to create a healthy environment is becoming more and more important, and they are also more and more working towards that.
Okay, I have a question. Mm-hmm. Thank you for giving us, I think, an example of how a traditional industry can embrace digitalization and provide value to customers throughout the life cycle. Mm-hmm. So I'm really curious of like when this happens and within the organization, was it like, how was the process of also introducing the new model to other people, like which may work more familiar with the traditional way? Also, how have been your customers perceived the new added value?
Yeah, if you look to digital transition, then the technology part of it is not that difficult. So, of course, there's a lot of work to be done. But it's done by people like you, programming and developers and engineers. But digital transition is more about mindset inside a company. So that's very difficult. It's difficult to change the mindset of, for example, account managers who were used to just sell products and not think about, hey, I now need to sell services with a recurring revenue and with added value, which I have to translate then, and without anything solid in front of me, without a real product in front of me. And also the change of what the business model does. So looking at remote service, for example, it really changes the way that people inside the organization can work. So our service department, first they got a call for a problem, and they just were phoning with the customer about, okay, what is the problem, to find out where the product is, what kind of product. And now they can use those tools to proactively call the customer. So it's the other way around. They can call the customer and say, hey, your product has a problem. We either can come and fix it, or I can send a spare part, or I can guide you through it to solve the issue. So it's a complete different way of working, which you are also introducing into the company. And that's the biggest challenge of digital transition. So.
And how have the customers, like, is it easy for them to like accept the new way of working?
It's different. It's if you look to big service organizations, then they are already... Yeah, they see that they need to use those tools to make their business more efficient. So they are embracing it, but it's always some ambassadors inside that company who are embracing it. But they have the same goals and the same challenges to also do the digital transition into their company. And of course, the installation business is conservative. So it's also a huge effort for them to also change the organization, also to new business models. If you now look to big installers, then you see that they still have an installation department and a service department. So the installation department, they are putting up a building, and they don't think about at the life cycle after that installation. They only think, hey, we have to put that installation in, fix it, commission it, and then we are finished. And then the service guys say, hey, watch it. If you are putting that in place, why don't you also add some extra sensors or add some extra stuff that we can do our service more easy? So there's also a big change needed in those companies to change mindset and how to approach this digital transition.
Thank you.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. For maybe any students interested in an internship, would you have any tips for them?
Please apply. I think we have great possibilities within Aalberts, not only within Hydronic Flow Control, but within Aalberts. We are working with some great customers, big customers, on different topics, and always on very niche technologies or mission critical technologies. So always technologies that matter, and I think there's a nice challenge in that to bring that further. What is very important is to really look at culture. So, like I said, we like entrepreneurs and people who like to try out things and to find out more than what we are normally doing, and take ownership.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? No? Then thank you all for coming, and thank you so much for your talk. Follow us on codum.nl/codumx or YouTube, Instagram to keep up to date to the next CodumX talk. Please, one big round of applause.
Thank you.